The next item of business is topical questions, and at question number one, I call Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, in light of the publication of the Grenfell report, what plans it has to ensure that the reported 107 buildings identified in its cladding remediation programme are fixed, including how many will be remediated this year.
Minister Paul McLennan.
We are determined lessons are learned from the Grenfell Inquiry report last week and to accelerate delivery. Pilot assessments have been undertaken for 30 entries, with works to mitigate or remediate risks having started on 5. With the Act and Single Building Assessment specification now in place, 107 pilot entries are undergoing necessary pre-assessment checks before proceeding to assessment. We have identified 12 pilot entries in scope without a link developer, where we will commission SBAs as a priority this autumn. Where a developer is identified, we expect them to play their part in assessment and remediation.
Stephen Kerr.
Well, I thank the Minister for his reply. I didn't quite catch all of the detail of what he said in terms of numbers, so let me ask him again if I might. It was reported in the press last weekend that only £11 million of the £97 million the Scottish Government received in 2020-21 for cladding remediation has been spent. Is this true? How much of the £97 million has been set aside for this year? How much this year and next year for remediation? Because the newspaper story also said that the Scottish Government had spent the balance of the money it hadn't spent for remediation on something else. So is it budgeted? Is it budgeted this year, next year, and if so, how much? There are 107 buildings in the highest category of risk. Is that correct? How many have been surveyed? How many of them have been remediated?
Let's keep our questions concise, Mr Kerr. Minister?
Yes, thank you, President. I'll try and touch on the points he's mentioned. He mentioned about 30 entries, pilot assessment has been taken, work or immediate has started on 5. 107 entries are going through pre-assessment checks before proceeding to assessment. There's 12 pilot entries in scope, which are without a linked developer, where we'll commission SBAs as part of that. And obviously, where a developer is identified, we expect them to play their part in assessment and remediation. As part of the funding, there was £97 million set aside in consequentials. I think what we've identified this year is an allocation of £29.07 million in 23-24 and a further £41.3 million in 24-25. I think, talking around about the process, we obviously have to undertake the pre-assessment checks and then the SBA process to identify the exact line of work that's required at that particular time. So until we undertake the full assessment, then obviously we won't know and we can't spend the funds that are there. Obviously, we're talking around about a building safety levy, and we've been talking to the UK Government around about that as well. And of course, developers have to pay their part as well. And again, we've been undertaking discussions with developers also on that.
Stephen Kerr.
Unfortunately, the Minister's answer seems to suggest that not a lot has happened in terms of actual remediation. And that is the focus of the anxiety that many of the residents in these high-risk buildings are living with. A question arises, why in Scotland do we seem to be so far behind England and Wales on this? What assessment has the Minister made about the capacity of the Scottish construction sector to undertake the remediation? When will the surveys be done? When will the work be completed? Will he publish a timetable, and if so, when?
Minister.
Yeah, there's a lot of questions in the presiding officer, and I'll write to Mr Kerr on the specific points. I think I mentioned it already twice in the answers in terms of the pilot assessments that have been undertaken and the others that are undergoing pre-assessment checks. But I'll happy to write to the member on that specific point. In terms of the pace of work, yes, we acknowledge that needs to be quickened. I think that's the part of the reason that we brought the cladding remediation bill to Parliament, and it was passed last year in terms of that. And of course, we have to accelerate pace. That also includes working with developers as well to make sure that they play their part in terms of that also. But we need to go through the SBA process, first of all, to identify what work is actually required to be carried out. But happy to write in further detail to Mr Kerr on that point.
McPherson.
A significant number of the affected buildings around my constituency, and it's an issue of concern for many of my constituents, which is why I've lodged a portfolio question on this matter tomorrow. In the interim, at this point, can I ask the Minister to provide an update on how provisions in Scotland's Cladding Remediation Act, such as the Cladding Register, can improve the confidence of residents in affected buildings and as their buildings are assessed and remediated? And can the Minister give an update generally on the implementation of the Act?
Minister.
Thank you. The new Act, and I think that's why I was delighted to take the Bill through Parliament in May to try and recognise how we quicken the pace. The new Act will provide confidence to high-rise residents in a number of ways. It will provide confidence that assessment and any remediation will be carried out to robust standards backed by statute. And I've already published the technical specification for the single buildings assessment to enable parties to get ready for assessments. And I know Mr McPherson and his constituents we've met to discuss that also. It will also provide confidence that any necessary steps to make the building safer are identified and can be acted upon. And also through its provisions on a responsible developer scheme, it will provide confidence that developers are playing their part in addressing the problems identified. And through its provisions on a cladding assurance register, it will provide confidence that the work has been done and they will be able to demonstrate this to lenders and insurers.
Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Diamonds and Company have published research that has shown that there are potentially up to 5,500 high-rise buildings that are in need of remediation. And given that we have only remediated one building in Scotland so far since Grenfell 7 years ago, can I ask the Government if they have had a chance to analyse that figure of 5,500 and whether the Government are setting a target for remediation completion?
Minister.
Supports obviously over the weekend. I haven't heard directly from Mr Diamond himself. Obviously, I'm sure he will write to us with details of that, and we'll happy obviously consider where he finds that figure from, and happy again to write to Mr Griffin on that particular point. In terms of the figures that I talked about, you know, we talked around about the single buildings assessments have to be carried out first of all. In terms of the pilot programme, it's in terms there. That will obviously identify any work that's been carried out. And I think that's, you know, in terms of where then identify the work that needs to be carried out, what the timescales are. But happy to write to Mr Griffin in more detail on that particular point.
Question number two, Neil Bibby.
To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on the Commonwealth Games potentially being hosted in Glasgow in 2026.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, President Officer. Discussions with the Commonwealth Games Federation, Commonwealth Games Scotland and the UK Government on a proposal for Glasgow 2026 are ongoing. Scottish Ministers have been clear about the financial pressures facing the public purse. We have a duty to balance potential benefits with the associated risks and ensure that staging the 26 Games would be the right thing for Scotland at this time. Given the proximity of the event, we are obviously working closely with stakeholders to confirm a final decision in the coming weeks.
Neil Bibby.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. £100 million of direct inward investment from the Commonwealth Games Federation is on the table for Glasgow should the city host the Games in 2026. This investment incentive is unheard of and would help lever in £150 million in economic benefits to the Glasgow City region and provide multi-million pound upgrades to venues such as Toll Cross and Scotstoun, opportunities for job creation, local procurement and tourism. Would the Minister agree that this £100 million investment on the table and the associated economic benefits presents an opportunity that the Scottish Government should seize?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President Officer, and I thank Neil Bibby for his question. I absolutely appreciate the work that Commonwealth Games Scotland and the Federation has done to get the revised concept for a new Commonwealth Games to this point. And it is precisely because we understand some of the potential benefits, as well as the importance to elite sport in Scotland, that we are continuing to engage and consider this alongside the potential risks that are there in terms of exposure to public funding that we cannot cover. So these discussions are ongoing. Obviously, we understand the potential benefits for the Glasgow economy, for tourism, for Scottish elite sport, and the future of the Commonwealth Games itself. And that's why we continue to give it very serious due consideration.
Neil Bibby.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that further answer. We should be ambitious for Glasgow and for Scotland, and we should seize the opportunity of that £100 million inward investment, which is not coming from public funds. Hosting the Games would provide sporting benefits as well as economic ones. Seizing the opportunity can act as a catalyst again for motivating volunteering in sport and creating international competitive pathways for our athletes, as well as showcasing Glasgow and Scotland to the world. We all here remember the fantastic Commonwealth Games in Glasgow in 2014, yet we shouldn't focus on the past but on the future. Every child in Scotland under the age of 16 either wasn't born or would struggle to remember it. An innovative and new format Games could provide children and young people of Scotland today a unique opportunity for them to witness and be inspired by world-class athletes on their doorstep. So does the Minister therefore agree that hosting the Games would show that we aren't just ambitious for Glasgow, for our economy and athletes, but also for our young people too?
Secretary.
Thank you very much indeed, President Officer. Again, I thank Neil Bibby for his question. Of course we're ambitious for Glasgow and for Scotland. Of course we are, and we understand the potential opportunities that are there. But it's important to stress that this concept is not a replica of 2014. And we have to understand and appreciate that. It is not going to be a rerun of what 2014 looks like. I mean, the budget that has been set aside for this compared to what was invested in 2014 serves to illustrate that fact. However, as a former athlete that had the career-ending injury whilst on a Commonwealth Games pathway, understand as well as anybody the importance of the Commonwealth Games to elite sport and grassroots sport in Scotland. Of course we do. However, there are risks inherent here that we need to bottom out, that we are working with both the UK Government, the Commonwealth Games Scotland and the Federation to understand. It's a new concept. It is untested. The figures that we're being quoted are ambitious, and of course we continue to be ambitious, but when there is an ambitious programme and an ambitious target within the financial envelope, that inherently draws risk. And we've already set out the situation that we have with the public purse, and so we need to be mindful of that as we continue those discussions with the UK Government, with Commonwealth Games Scotland and the Federation.
I'm keen to allow as many members as possible to put questions, so if we could keep our questions and responses concise, that would be helpful. And I call Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and come on, Glasgow. To ask the Scottish Government if they've been advised if there are cities in England or Wales who have been approached to host these games, and whether there has been confirmation that the UK Government would fully fund such an endeavour.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. I thank Bill Kidd for the question. On the first part, we've not been made aware of any other cities in England or Wales having been approached by the Federation to host the Games in 2026. We're therefore not aware of any decision requested or made by the UK Government to fully fund such an endeavour. And the reason that we are in continued discussions with the UK Government is to understand the UK Government's position on that for Glasgow. The UK did previously consider a Four Nations proposal in 2023, and the UK Government announced in December 23 that such a proposal would not be supported and that it would be in the best interest of the movement for it to be hosted elsewhere.
Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you. Glasgow is an incredible city with amazing people who would undoubtedly put on a fantastic show. And like last time, we trust the sun to shine on our city during the Games. If, or hopefully when, the 2026 Games do come to Glasgow, what are the Scottish Government's specific strategies to ensure that hosting the Games would deliver lasting social, economic and cultural benefits for Glasgow's communities? Because evaluation of the 2014 Games showed limited improvement in population-level health, physical activity and sports participation.
Cabinet Secretary.
Legacy from major events is absolutely at the heart of our major event strategy, making sure that we do garner lasting legacy, both in terms of infrastructure and in terms of participation and population health benefits and wider cultural aspects. This revised concept on a much reduced budget makes that more challenging, as Mr. Gulhani, I'm sure, would appreciate, compared to what we had with 2014. And I reiterate the point to Mr. Gulhani, as I did to Mr. Bibby, that this is not a replica of 2014. This is a smaller version, proposed fewer sports over fewer sites, and so therefore there is a reputational risk as well as a financial risk that Glasgow is carrying, because he is absolutely right. Glasgow and Scotland has an international reputation for major events hosting, doing so incredibly successfully. I point to the World Cycling Championships, the World Indoor Athletics, most recent examples of that. And so we need to make sure that this concept, as well as the financial considerations around it, are right for Scotland at this time.
Patrick Harvey.
If the government concludes that the balance of risks and benefits is positive, then I would certainly welcome the Games coming to Glasgow. Even though it won't be a replica of 2014, it would still be a major event for the city, and we need to mitigate any unintended consequences. So would the Cabinet Secretary work with Glasgow City Council to ensure that there's a rapid use of the visitor levy powers to ensure that some of the money that can be generated from the economic activity is invested back in social purposes? And would he also ensure that the government considers, if the housing bill is not yet in force, the use of temporary rent control measures in the region to prevent price gouging that we have seen in the period of some major sporting events?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Mr Harvey for that question. Of course, Glasgow City Council would be central partners in the delivery of a Games coming to Glasgow. They have a very, very strong, internationally renowned reputation for the delivery of major events going back to 2014 and beyond. And so, of course, they would be very strong partners, and some of those points that Mr Harvey raised would be part of the consideration. But the immediate consideration for us is whether this prospect, this concept that has been devised, is right for Glasgow, right for Scotland, and we will obviously be continuing the discussions because we understand the importance of the Commonwealth Games and its future to Scottish elite sport. We'll be continuing those discussions to look at every possible eventuality and up until the point that we take a final decision.
Sweeney.
I thank the President for calling me. The Cabinet Secretary has outlined some of the issues he is wrestling with, but the Commonwealth Games Federation has highlighted that it will have to come to a conclusion sooner rather than later. Can he highlight to the Chamber what the approaching deadline is and what is the time frame we're looking at? Is it a matter of weeks or is it months?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank Mr Sweeney for his question. I said in at my first answer to Mr Bibby that we'll be looking to conclude matters in the coming weeks. And obviously every passing day makes the delivery of an event in itself more challenging, because we're already at a very tight timescale, and that is additionally one of the considerations that we've got around risk, is whether or not this can be achieved within the time available. And so obviously we want to give clarity to Commonwealth Games Scotland and the Commonwealth Games Federation as quickly as possible, which is why the intensity of engagement with the UK Government and others has intensified, so that we can arrive at a decision as soon as possible.
You move on to question three, and I call Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, in light of the recent reported dog attack in Aberdeenshire, what effect the restriction on XL bully-type dogs have had on the incidence of dog attacks?
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, I thank the police for their swift action, and I wish the people injured in this incident a speedy recovery. While I cannot discuss details of live cases, incidents such as these illustrate the dangers that arise if any dog is not kept under effective control, which is why we support responsible dog ownership, whatever breed of dog is owned. The Scottish Government took action to introduce safeguards on XL bully dogs, specifically to ensure public safety following the impact in Scotland of steps taken by the UK Government in England and Wales. These new safeguards include measures that meant XL bully dog owners must ensure their dogs are muzzled on a lead in order to reduce risk when in a public place. We continue to work with key stakeholders to encourage responsible dog ownership, no matter the breed of the dog, to help drive down the incidence of dog attacks.
Christine Graham.
Can I also endorse the Cabinet Secretary's words about the people who were so horrifically attacked? While the Cabinet Secretary didn't actually answer my question, can I therefore ask her, does the government hold data on, say, the top 10 breeds known to have been involved in attacks on people or indeed on other dogs? And if she doesn't hand it, she could perhaps write to me with it.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, President Officer, I'll try better to answer Ms Graham's questions. There is data available from the NHS on inpatient and day case admissions to hospital where a dog attack was recorded as the reason. There is also information on the National Records Scotland on deaths from being bitten or struck by a dog. However, data on the breed or type of dogs involved is not recorded, and so there is no central record within Scotland or indeed the UK of the sort that the member is asking about. However, my ministerial colleagues Siobhan Brown and Jim Fairley would be happy to engage further with Ms Graham to discuss what more can be done in this area to gather more data.
Christine Graham.
Well, I welcome progress in trying to identify which breeds are, because you know my long-standing policy has been that it's the deed, not the breed. Given that these horrific attacks are, my Welfare of Dogs Bill is trying to address this by making sure people become responsible owners, but given that these are horrific attacks, can the Minister advise what information is held on the circumstances of these attacks? And if so, where this is kept? I know you mentioned the NHS, because I think that would help in informing policy and behaviour.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, Ms Graham raises a fair point. Some of the information held is, of course, very top level and somewhat general. She may be interested to know that Ministers Ms Brown and Mr Fairley will be having a Responsible Dog Ownership Summit on the 20th of September. And that is to look in general at the issues of dog control and good practice, but also dog welfare. And I'd be very surprised if data wasn't discussed at that meeting.
Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Of course, the restrictions in Scotland were somewhat delayed relative to the rest of the United Kingdom. That led to calls that perhaps there was an influx of dogs across the border. Can I ask if there's any evidence that was the case? And from a numerical or statistical point of view, how many XL bully-type dogs have been registered in Scotland, and are there any estimations whatsoever as to the volume of unregistered or illegally held dogs of this type?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, if I may resist Mr Green's temptation to rewrite history, it is important to put on the record once again that the previous UK government's engagement with the Scottish Government on this very serious matter was absolutely woeful, whereas my colleague Ms Brown found out about their new legislative measures via the BBC, and then when she sought to clarify matters, that was a somewhat frustrating experience. And it's also worth remembering that it was the previous UK government who created the loophole, and that this loophole gave a risk to unacceptable public safety and animal welfare issues. In terms of how many exemptions have been applied for or granted, that is 3,385. It is somewhat difficult to establish precise numbers of dog owners, never mind the precise numbers of dog owners who own specific breeds.
Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've heard from constituents who feel stigmatised and worried about the health and behaviour of their pets as a result of measures introduced through the XL bully legislation. So can I ask how the Cabinet Secretary is reacting to calls from such owners to revisit the legislation, given the detrimental impact on their and their pets' wellbeing?
Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government was faced with a difficult situation due to the actions of the previous UK Government, which affected Scotland, where we needed to balance, and I was very glad that we did take the action to balance public safety interests with the rights of XL bully dog owners. And I believe that we have found that balance. For example, the longer period for owners to seek an exemption in Scotland in comparison to England and Wales, and a more flexible approach in terms of neutering also. If I can say to the member that regular engagement with dog welfare stakeholders, such as the Scottish SPCA, the Dogs Trust, the British Veterinary Association, continues to help to minimise any undue impact on dog owners and, of course, the wellbeing of their dogs.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions. I'll allow a moment for front benches to organise before we move on to the next item of business.